The Mishcon Academy Digital Sessions.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Mishcon Dorea. My name is Jennifer Millins, and I'm a partner in Mishcon's employment team. Thank you so much for joining us this afternoon. At Mishcon, we work alongside our employer clients dealing with all of the challenges that improving diversity can bring. And we know that diversity and inclusion is one of the key challenges facing employers. Today's event aims to shed some light on this challenge and how technology can help employers to build strong and diverse teams. I'm delighted to welcome Stacia Sherman-Garr. Stacia is co-founder and principal analyst at Red Thread Research, which is a research and insights company focusing on people practices, learning and D&I, and the technologies that support them. I wanted to start by asking you about the evolution of diversity and inclusion in the workplace. And very briefly to set the scene, because we're referring in this as a sort of shorthand to D&I tech or D&I technology, just as a kind of easy way of signaling what we're talking about. But it's probably worth us just breaking that down a little bit.
To set a little bit of context, I've been doing research on this space, whether we call it D&I or DEIB, as we've started calling it, since 2013. And I think that the changes that we've seen in that time have been pretty foundational. Now, I felt that in from the research that we did, that there was a big energy behind it in 2017, 2018, and part of 2019. And that's when we started to see the tech market really take off. But to be honest, it was starting to die back a little bit of, okay, we've had this push on Me Too, what now? And then, you know, what now was the pandemic. But I remember at the time thinking, Where's the conversation around D&I here? Like we're just not having it. And if anybody think, you know, a crisis almost always disproportionately negatively impacts diverse individuals. And so that was kind of my thinking in March and April. And then here in the United States, we had the social justice movements in June, and all of a sudden D&I really took off.
And I know a lot of our audience will know only too well, and improving diversity within an organization will require a combination of changes to systems, practices, behaviors, analysis of data, increased insight on what people are thinking and feeling. I mean, that involves an awful lot of work over a sustained period of time. Is technology then the missing link in all of this?
It is a critical missing link. The reason for that is that technology enables us to do some really important things and enables us to track data in a way that is much more sustainable, holistic, et cetera. It critically can pull that information up at moments of decision-making. And that is one of the big things, having an awareness that, hey, I might have some unconscious bias here, and wait, here's some data that shows it. Hey, there might be some other factors I should be considering that were not kind of in my historical purview. The technology can do that if done well, and we can certainly talk about AI and bias, but if done well, it can show us our own biases in a non-aggressive fashion. So the data simply says that I tend to write emails like this to this type of person, and I tend to write emails like this to that type of person. And that's consistent across, you know, 3 years of email. So maybe actually I am making some decisions that I'm not aware of.
So you talked about some of the benefits and risks of using this sort of technology. And AI is an interesting one. Is that where the risk kind of starts and ends, or do you think there are wider risks of using this kind of technology if it's not done properly?
Yeah, well, I think one thing that's really been heartening is that when we started this work in 2019, or 2018, the understanding of the risks with regard to AI was relatively low, and now it is much higher. But in terms of your question about overall risks, there certainly are the usual risks with technology of implementation. You know, it doesn't get implemented right, it doesn't get used right, people don't understand how to use it, they don't use it, etc. I think also there is, and I think this is an important discussion for this audience, there is the fact that by understanding particularly the data, there is potentially some legal risk that could be incurred, some reputational risks. And so the risk is going to be, if you did not do that look now, and if you did not work towards it in 3 to 5 years, where you're going to be, that's where I think the real kind of risk lies. The third one that is worth talking about, though, and this is important across any of the data analytics technology we talk about, is that of trust and ethics. If, you know, I gave an example of you know, technology potentially giving me feedback on my email and how I'm communicating. Mm-hmm. Well, that starts to sound very Big Brother very quickly if that information is used in the wrong way, is not used to benefit me.
So some of it is about having a long-term plan or vision about what you're going to do with the results of your analysis, particularly when you're talking about data analytics. And the plan needs to be, I think, a lot more long-term than just mm-hmm. let's get some technology in that can help us with this.
And I think that's an important point, that long-term thinking. I think it's very easy for us to say, oh, well, we'll just hire more diverse people, or we'll just put in this program and that'll fix it. And we've been doing that for 30, 40, 50 years, right? And I think that we need to have in place that strategy and to understand, you know, one, a lot of this is fundamentally about organizational culture, and that takes time to change, and that takes time to adjust behaviors and to adjust processes and systems and the like. And that can be a bit of a hard message, but I hope that with what's happened this last summer, we've seen one, it's worth it, but two, that, you know, the incrementalist approach that we've taken to date hasn't done it. So we need to be making these investments with that long-term vision and then continually working towards them and holding ourselves accountable for reaching the interim goals.
We've seen that the majority of our audience are new to diversity and inclusion technology. Where do they start?
I think analytics, because you want to have a baseline, back to your point about ROI, you want to have a baseline of where you are today, and you need to be able to create accountability in the future and then to prove that you've done something. Then I would be looking at both our diversity and inclusion strategy, as well as our HR and broader business strategy, to understand what are the most critical populations for our business, who do we need to be focusing on generally, and what is the biggest need, and then you know, extrapolate that to the D&I use case. So if you are having challenges if you need to bring in certain types of populations through your talent acquisition process, focus on those from a diversity perspective. If you're having a hard time retaining certain populations, focus on them from an inclusion perspective and take kind of the DEIB lens there. But it absolutely has to map back to whatever your HR strategy is and your diversity and inclusion strategy is.
We've brought together, and we're very lucky to have some of the leading lights in diversity and inclusion technology. So we have got with us today, we've got Kate Plaskovova, who is founder and CEO at FairHQ. FairHQ provides a self-service platform that helps companies understand their diversity and inclusion practices and embed their D&I in their businesses. We've got with us Kiati Sundaram, who is CEO at Be Applied, a recruitment platform that helps businesses find the best person for the job, regardless of background. And we've got Dr. Zara Nanu with us. And Zara is CEO and co-founder of GapSquare. GapSquare has developed software which allows businesses to analyze and track pay disparity statistics and produce reports on equality and diversity gender, such as for the gender pay gap reporting in the UK. And last but not least, we have my fabulous colleague, Dan Sinclair. And Dan will be my co-chair on this panel. I'm going to start our questions for today with a bit of an open one to you, Kiati. So we talked in just that discussion with Stacia just now that diversity positively impacts the bottom line, but there's often a frustration that the progress on diversity and inclusion within the workplace is too slow. What do you think are the main reasons for that lack of success?
I think it's important to talk about unconscious bias and why that creeps in and how that creeps in. There's decades of evidence that says, as a society, we are very, very far away from achieving neutrality in explicit bias, mm-hmm. and even like centuries away from achieving neutrality in implicit bias.
And do you think then that the technology, like the sort of technology that Applied is offering, will help accelerate that change?
So we are at the cusp of tech, behavioral science, and diversity and equality. And we've seen that through our applications. We've now had about 300,000 applications through Applied. What we do essentially is remove anything that is non-predictive. And we test for what matters on the job. So every piece of information that sits on a CV or a resume or a LinkedIn profile is firstly not predictive, so it's noise. It's not giving me any signal of, oh, you're called Jennifer, so you would be great at doing your job at MDR. Mm. It doesn't tell me anything, so it's noise. And the second thing it does is it prevents people who don't look the part from applying. And so what we find is, one, by having solved for creating a debias system throughout the hiring funnel, we've created a new architecture which can systematize a lot of these biases out of the hiring process.
We're trying to understand the minds of the leaders of, you know, of businesses. And I'm just trying to understand whether this is an issue across the market, across the economy. And Kate, I just wanted to bring you in on this point. Since launching, you're working primarily at the moment with startups, SMEs, scaling tech businesses who are growing really quickly. And I'm just so curious to learn whether you've had any observations about how those leaders think about businesses. Are you seeing that they are being more intentional about how diversity is core at the beginning?
So we went the other way around and started focusing exactly, as you said, like on the smaller businesses where they are not steering this massive ship from the direction where they were like actually building up, and they actually have the moments in their business when they're building, hiring more people, growing, they can make a lot of changes and build that organization from the ground up as more diverse and inclusive. We're working with early adopters, which are all the people that are like loving the diversity inclusion. They are been done lots of initiatives internally, but where we are helping them is to systemize it and to actually help them to prioritize.
Following that, Zara, I wanted to ask you, I guess, about the teeny tiny matter that is the future of work. I'm curious to learn your thoughts around whether the way that the economy will change going forward, are those the right ingredients to lead to better D&I outcomes?
Yeah, so originally we've set up GapSquare, which is the company that I co-founded and I run, about 5 years ago, specifically to address kind of a big elephant in the room of diversity and inclusion. And that was a World Economic Forum report that was saying it will be 217 years before the gender pay gap is closed. At the same time, they were releasing reports talking about how we will be on our way to Mars by 2030. We will all be in self-driving cars by 2030. So the thought was, how come technology and data is helping us accelerate all of that, and yet we still will be 200 years away from achieving pay parity? We started by looking at kind of companies, HR and payroll data, bringing it together so that they can understand where the gaps are, why they have gaps, and how they can take more data-driven decisions to eliminate those gaps. So I think COVID has really exposed a lot of those for us, with women being significantly affected by the pandemic. We need a new kind of world. We need a new kind of economy that values other metrics, that doesn't value just shareholders' returns, but actually takes into account all stakeholders. And in that kind of economy, the kind of the stakeholder capitalism, if you will, we need to review how we do work. We need to review how we view certain occupations, why we view certain occupations as being less productive than others, because productivity as currently measured is very much linked to the GDP. And the GDP, again, is something we've inherited from post-World War and is not at all looking at digital tech to begin with, but also a lot of the output that women do in the economy is valued at significantly less. If we do nothing and continue to walk into this, we will have no one else to blame but ourselves for being in a very male-dominated economy by 2025.
You know, when you look at the landscape of men that take companies public, they do it in their 20s and in some cases their early 20s. I want to hear your experiences of raising capital and what, you know, what's broken about that, what needs to change going forward.
Studies have shown that bias exists. I had a co-founder, my previous startup, who was male. And when we would go together to pitches, I would really experience a different kind of sentiment and questions from investors. So 90% of the time, I would be told, come back to us when you are demonstrating 5 years of traction or experience, for example. Whereas when my co-founder went by himself to the pitches, he was asked completely different questions about community building or how is your brand? And a lot of the times what that does is inadvertently sets up the minority group for failure.
Do you think that shareholders have an obligation to drive forward the D&I agenda?
I think absolutely. And I think we really need to change thinking away from shareholders into overall stakeholders. And that is already happening on a global level by more companies choosing to register as B Corps and therefore changing their articles of association completely so that they're not just liable to shareholders, because that restricts them in their action and the metrics that they might want to look at, but opens them up to be more inclusive of all the stakeholders, on be they shareholders, be they partners, consumers, anyone who buys the products or services. And that's really the right way to do it.
I'd like to thank you all for joining us this afternoon and wish you a very lovely evening. Thank you very much.
The Mishcon Academy Digital Sessions. To access advice for businesses that is regularly updated, please visit mishcon.com.